Welcome to Alpha, the city of a thousand planets.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Underrated Podcast. This is a podcast where we discuss the films that we feel are underrated, underappreciated, or ones that have just slipped under the radar and passed most people by. I am Derek McDuff, and with me today is Alan Torres.
Hey, what's up, guys?
And Ariel Ortiz.
Hello.
And together we are the Undercast Company. This is going to be the first episode of a kind of mini-series that we're doing called Big Swing. And each week this month, we are going to be talking about a very specific kind of underrated movie, the movies that I have kind of dubbed as these Big Swing movies. These are like kind of over the top, massively ambitious movies that more often than not fail at the box office and tend to be pretty mixed with critics. To kind of specify these movies, I've picked out five criteria that they kind of always fulfill. So these are films that are hugely imaginative. They have just huge special effects budgets. So we're talking, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars. Very impressive world building. Kind of bonkers. They're just weird ass films.
Did you say hundreds of thousands of dollars?
Hundreds of millions of dollars. Thank you for correcting me there.
Yeah.
Hundreds of millions of dollars.
What we're gonna be talking to? Wasn't it like a couple million?
Yeah, no. Gotta be in the billion dollars. Nine digits. So over $100 million budget films. And then they also can't be part of a pre-existing franchise because those films, unlike a lot of the films we're going to be talking about, tend to succeed. So something I would say like Pirates of the Caribbean 2 and 3 were like these weird big bonkers movies with a lot of world building, but they built on the success of another film that came out. So, you know, they don't really qualify in this, I would say. Whereas opposed to these films, they might be based on like a YA novel or like a manga or something, or in this case, a French graphic novel. And though they don't really have the baked in fan base that, you know, something like a multi-million dollar film franchise would have. The big swing we're going to be talking about today is the one that I feel does these things the best. And that is a film called Valerian and the City of a Thousand Planets, which is a 2017 film directed by Luc Besson, starring Dane, DeHaan, and Cara Delevingne. And I think that the reason I chose this film is because, like I said, it does all of these things better than probably any other big swing movie. Like, it's the most big swing of the big swing movies. It's not the best. The best is, I think, one we've already talked about on this podcast called Speed Racer. But it really is just like there's like all this world building that like doesn't really need to be there, but it's there. They'll just like stop the movie for a minute to be like, and here's how the city works. It's kind of bonkers. There's all these plots that never go anywhere. These movies, big swings, they do tend to have kind of problems, but I think these kind of movies, it's almost impossible to just compare them to just like your average film because they're so weird and over the top and just imaginative and unique, just like, nothing is like them, and that's what I love about them, is just how unique they feel. They almost feel like like the only thing close to them is animation. Like, nothing else really looks like them and these films could not even exist maybe like 15 or more years ago because just the technology wasn't there. But yeah, like I said, this was my pick. I'll go more into it. I just kind of wanted to give everybody an intro into the big swing premise in general. What about you guys? Had you guys seen this movie before?
I purposely didn't see this movie before. Yeah.
How about you, Alan?
I hadn't seen it. I wanted to go see it because it looked really bonkers. And you know what? I'd be down for it. But I just, at the time, I was like, there was other big blockbusters coming out. So I think I put that on the back burner. And I was like, oh, I'll get to it.
Yeah, I really feel like this movie, if I remember correctly, came out like pretty much like in a time where a lot of other like more appealing and more like, I don't want to say like better movies came out.
Oh, yeah, you're not wrong.
Yeah, I have a feeling. Yeah, like I, it's vague, but just like that kind of feeling of that it was like, yeah, like yeah. Already had a lot against it.
Well, yeah, it came out, like, I'm looking right now at some of the movies that it was going up against, mm-hmm. and it went up against Dunkirk, which is, like, clearly a better film, but it's hard mm-hmm. to how do you compare a movie like this to Dunkirk? You know, like, that's, and, you know, and then also, apparently, Despicable Me 3 was out at the same time, and Girls Trip, so, like, a lot of movies that made a lot of money came out, and that's kind of the thing about these kind of movies, and we'll probably get into it more with some of the other big swings, probably the next one we're going to be talking about, we're going to talk about a little more, but these movies have to make a lot of money to even break even. This was actually the most expensive independent film ever made. But yeah, that's the thing about these movies is you can always see every dollar is on the screen. Like, they look incredible no matter what. And it's just great to see this weirdness realized. Even if it's like not necessarily your cup of tea, you're just like, it's a feast for the eyes. But yeah, why don't you guys talk about your impressions of the film? I'd love to hear them.
Oh, well, first, real quick, what's the, just for the listeners, what's like the basic plot for Valerian? I mean, I know it's been out but for a little while, but it is kind of like a, kind of just jumps into it, to be honest.
Yeah,
the best that I could say, put the premise would be that it's kind of like, not swashbuckling, but kind of like this, kind of what's I'm not I can't think of the word like not renegade, but kind of Fifth Element, but more I'm talking about like Valerian himself of being kind of like this laid back kind of cop. You know, it's kind of because, it's kind of like essentially like a cop stumbles onto a bigger government conspiracy and it kind of like goes through this world, and that's but that core is that kind of like cop and his you know like tough knuckled partner
it's one of these movies where almost the plot doesn't matter as much as just like the setting and the aesthetic. And it's interesting, you know, Ariel, that it's actually the same director who did The Fifth Element, so that's why it kind of is very reminiscent. Luc Besson, who, by the way, is a big fucking creep. I just wanted to put that out there. That guy sucks. Didn't want to get through the podcast without saying that he's a big old creeper.
Fifth Element's a really good movie, though.
Fifth Element's great, like, and you know, it's because it's kind of like a really interesting premise for like a place because this. Is like it's this city that got built up. It started as like a space station, and then other like the U.S. space station, and then like other like you know countries started coming, and then we had first contact with aliens, and other aliens came, and then it got too big to become with Earth. And there's all this like extended prologue where you see the city kind of get built, and it gets pushed off into space, and now it's just like this kind of amalgamation of like all these thousands of different species all living on this kind of just massive space station. That's why it's called the City of a Thousand Planets. And it's kind of about the space cop getting to the bottom of this conspiracy about this planet that was destroyed during this war with and Clive Owen is an asshole. And it's just kind of like, and it just goes on off all these weird tangents. Like Rihanna just becomes a main character for about 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And then
disappears and just disappears from the movie. It's like bizarre, but I love it.
Yeah. So I think I should start going off of that. I like the aesthetics of the movie. You cannot like dismiss the, you know, the sheer, like they pulled it off. Like they pulled off like this incredible visual, picture and like setting, and it, you know, you definitely like are immersed in that world. My biggest thing though, on this is kind of like story-wise I felt like there was a lot like going off of that. There was a lot of too many tangents, and there was a lot of tangents that definitely weren't necessary. I think like the whole point where from the point where they kind of get separated to the time when they get reunited, that all could have been cut out. And I'm sure that was in the graphic novel, and I feel like that was very much like a graphic novel kind of like subplot that usually graphic novels have, especially like international graphic novels. They kind of have that like kind of like sub plot that kind of like
intermission. It's a long running series. It's kind of like one of those long running series, so they probably just pull from different plot lines, I think. Yeah.
But I mean, even if I'm like going off a manga, like, you know, like you have like they have a beach day, you know, in the middle of them going to you know, to fight evil things and stuff like that. So it's a common theme for that. And I felt like it doesn't really play for a movie like this. I did actually enjoy the story of the aliens that's planet got destroyed. I felt like that was very interesting plot and like a really good twist on, like we said, like a conspiracy, government conspiracy and cover up. The one thing that I didn't like, and that's probably a big no for this movie, is the main character of Valerian. He was very much incredibly a groomer of his partner, and essentially kind of like grooming her to like fall in love with him. And I felt like, now looking back, I feel like the movie probably would have been a lot better if it was just her. Like in her character,
she is a more interesting character.
She is a more interesting character, and then they like kind of dumb her down in midway. Like, you know, like all suddenly, like, oh, she needs Valerian's help for everything, while she like in the beginning was so much of a capable character. So like she kind of like randomly becomes a damsel in distress midway through. And I didn't really appreciate that, and especially, like, you know, they kind of, like, created this really good character with her, and I'm sure, like, the source material, like, could have, like, the Valerian in that might have been a lot better, and they tried to probably just, like, in an attempt to Americanize it a bit, kind of, like, changed it a bit in the wrong way, but yeah, that's my overall, like, it was an okay movie. I felt like it could have been cut down a lot, and it was kind of on the longer side, especially if they cut out, like, I think that was like 20 minutes? I think it was like about half an 20, hour.
20, 30 minutes, yeah, where it's just like, yeah. Oh, here's Rihanna and Ethan Hawke and like,
yeah,
the king.
Yeah.
And it doesn't add anything to the movie, like, I mean, but I kind of love it.
That's the thing, too, is that with killing off Rihanna's character, who ended up being, like, an okay character, mm-hmm. By killing her off, there was no reason for that middle section. Like, if she had carried on with them in their travels, then that might have made the middle section, like, a bit more, you know, like useful. You know, but by killing her off, like, pretty much, like, oh, like, it's kind of like in a video game, like, you beat this level or beat this world. Oh, you're the person that was your guide through this world died, kind of thing. And kind of like, okay, we're going to be going on then, I guess. So that's my take on this. Definitely very visually beautiful. I did like I think the most impressive part of the movie was when Valerian, you know, was basically going through all these cities chasing after the aliens and stuff, like just crashing through all these walls, and then each wall goes into another world. I really very much enjoyed that sequence.
Yeah, world building insane in this movie.
Oh yeah, insane. Mm-hmm. I love the lore of this movie. I love the lore of the alpha, like, that was incredible lore, and they did it so precise and so, like, it wasn't like it didn't take up too much time, you know. It was I really actually enjoyed that it was like essentially no dialogue to it. It was, and then with the simpleness of the acceptance of, like, just shaking hands, of that's like, okay, now we have another
with the Bowie plane.
We have another, Yeah, or like, yeah, no, just, yeah, exactly. And like, just like the shaking of hands, like, oh yeah, now we have another and another and another. And it's, but the consistently of consistency of them shaking hands, it was, yeah, it was that was like a really good start to a movie and like world building of this, like, you know, city, planet of a thousand, city of a thousand planets, you know?
Mm.
Yeah.
Well, to kind of jump off, I do agree. I'll say this. I liked the movie a lot. I thought it was a lot of fun. Thought it came out 20 years too late. It definitely felt like it would have fit perfectly in the 90s. Like
an 80s movie. Oh, okay.
Felt more like in the 90s, like that Fifth Element, Demolition Man kind of like type of film. And I really enjoyed that part. You can see the money plastered all over this film. The only thing that kind of bothered me was it was the scene where they were like at that massive like marketplace where they had to wear like the goggles or whatever, and then they could see.
Oh my gosh, I totally forgot that part.
The lighting was really bad because it looked like they were supposed to be in like a desert, like a bazaar. And you can tell that, like, the actors, like, whatever was CG, like a CG character, perfectly in that spot. Lighting was good for them. But it totally looked like they were kind of like this. Like, whenever it was a real actor, you can tell, like, the studio lighting was like this. And it just looked so awkward. And I just couldn't stop focusing on that. But other than that, that was my only gripe for, like, the CGI and stuff. But the City of a Thousand Planets was gorgeous. I loved all the different, like you said, when he's going through the like the little biomes or whatever, and he's crashing through them, that was a lot of fun. I didn't feel that Valerian was a groomer. I felt that Valerian and Cara Delevingne's character,
Loreline,
were just obnoxiously horny for each other. Like, I was just like, oh my god, just.
Well, like, they start off with like them basically like suggestively wrestling,
overly, you know? Suggesting. I was like, just put it in, dude. Like, like, it was just so like the whole time, every interaction between them was just like, I'm angrily horny at you. Like, that's how I felt all the time around them, where I was like, geez, like, if they don't get together, that would be the biggest twist of the film. But obviously they do, and they're like, oh my god, like, Valerian was just a fucking cheese ball. Like I felt like he was trying to be like just some big action star from the 90s, but he's kind of like this scrawny little nerdy guy. And like,
I have some thoughts about
somehow,
that.
Somehow, like, Loreline is like, oh my god, I need to fuck this little dude so bad. And I was just like, okay, whatever. Like, I will say Loreline was my favorite character. She was a lot of fun. The damsel in distress thing kind of was there. But she did rescue him, too. So I felt like, okay, there was a little like, hey, I saved you, you saved me kind of thing. But
yeah,
all I could say, they were just obnoxiously horny for each other. That was their character. That's the chemistry. There's like, you know, you watch like a romantic film or whatever, and there's a chemistry there, you know, whatever, in The Notebook or whatever, you know, and you feel it there, you're like, oh, that's romantic. These guys were just like they were just soaking in their pants of like, I just need to bang you right now. Like, I'm sorry, but like, I couldn't stop laughing at that. Like, that was like pure comedy. And then one of my absolute favorite moments that made me go, all right, I like this movie for all the bad reasons, is I think it's like, again, the bizarre scene with like the marketplace, and then he has like, Valerian has a gun up to some dude's head, and then he's just like, I can't let you do that. And the guy's like, why, or something, and he's like, because it's the law. And I'm like, what the fuck was that? Like, you might as well have just said, because it's good, or for justice. Like, I was like, that was because, the hammiest delivery
ever. It's like, wrong.
It's wrong. It's the law, like fucking and like Judge Dredd or some shit.
Yeah.
But like, yeah, I was like, this is so hammy. Like, I'm like, all right, like that's one of those. That was the moment where I was like, I'm leaving my brain at the door. Like, I don't know why I brought it. I threw it across the room and I was like, I'm in it. I'm in this for all the wrong reasons, and it was a lot of fun. And yeah, like I'd recommend it. It's just a fun movie. Like, it's a beautiful movie to look at. Horny chemistry, great action sequences. Like, it was fun, man. I had a great time with it.
Awesome. I'm glad to hear that. Cause yeah, that's kind of the whole like thing about the big swing movies for me, is like, they are movies where it's just like kind of a lot of times you just like, this is it's a different kind of movie experience. You know, the best way I can put it is like, they're movies that are like a combination of Moulin Rouge and Avatar, where they're just like big, like emotional, like movies with all these crazy effects. And like, the plots are like, never like, I obviously love a movie with a good plot, don't get me wrong, but like, the plots are not necessarily important here. It's all about just kind of like these interesting worlds and dynamics and stuff that they're building. And like, comparing this movie to a movie like Dunkirk, like, how do you even, like I said, how do you do that? Like, they're just like these big, they're always like these passion projects. A lot of times directors get them after they've like, you know, made some like really big success. You know, we'll talk about that more with Tomorrowland, you know, when we cover that movie. But yeah, they do, like, the plot of this movie is so interesting, because it's, not only is it kind of like weird of a plot, but like, the structure of the film is just insane. It's just, it doesn't make any sense. And it's almost refreshing, because you're like, okay, you know, when you watch a movie, you're like, oh, see, he said this, so that means this guy's going to come back later. You know, like, this happened, so this guy's going to be... And, like, none of that's there. Like, John Goodman shows up at the beginning of this movie, and he's like, I'll get you, Valerian.
Knew it was him. Knew it was him. Knew it. John Goodman.
So, and then you're like, oh, so, okay, so he's, like, he's, like, threatening him. He's going to show up at the end of the movie.
At that part, me and the bro who, you know, wasn't able to make it to the recording today, but... We were like, we turned to each other, like, is that John Goodman?
And then the same reaction.
Like, because it sounded like, at one point, he sounds like Sully. And like, so that was the trigger, what like caused us to like recognize his voice. But yeah.
But yeah, so like, he says, you know, I'll get you, Valerian, if it's the one last thing. And you're like, okay, so he's going to come back in the movie, because he's like this big actor. He's threatening to come get him. And then that's it. He just never shows up in the movie. That plot is just done and never addressed again.
I think this they were hoping for a franchise with this, and then I'll talk about it with another one that we're discussing also, of the big swings of Alito Battle Angel, where there's open ends to these movies.
Well, Alito, stuff in Alito that is like, feels like this is definitely set up for a sequel. It felt like this was just, that was the end of that plot line, and they like just. That was it, because there's other stuff in this movie that's so structurally weird, like the whole Rihanna thing. It's just like, she shows up, becomes the main character for 20 minutes, disappears, dies, has this emotional moment, and then nobody ever mentions her again. Or like, like when they first get to the city, they just stop the plot to like explain a bunch of world building that has no relevance. Like, none of that makes a difference. It's just cool shit that they want you to know about this invented world. And you're like, and there's this many cities, and there's these people that like do this. And you're like, they're like, these guys like live underwater, and these guys like are the tech. And like, you see that kind of in the background, but it has no relevance on the plot. But they literally stop the movie for like a minute.
Yeah.
And you're like, there's no way Valerian doesn't know all this.
It got me confused, because we were, I was like, wait, don't they live here? Isn't this their base? Like, and stuff, yeah, exactly. And when they say that, and then at the end they're like, we're home, and you're like, okay, yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Like, it's so structurally like weird, and I actually like kind of find that refreshing, because, you know, it's not necessarily like this is great cinema that needs to be replicated, but it's something interesting to see that's different, that I like to see different cinema. And that's, you know, the big conceit of these big swings, is there's not stuff like this. You don't get these kind of movies very often. One will come around every, you know, year or two. And I just love to see just like, it's all there. It's like, they're just going for it. They're just, you can tell that he really wanted to like tell this weird, interesting story, and like make sure that you knew how the city worked and how everything went, and like have a shapeshifter character who was going to go in this like weird hall. None of that matters. But it was all there, and I'm glad I got to see it, because it was so fucking weird and interesting. And I will always love movies that take big chances like this. And that's where the big swing comes from, because it is like a big swing and it's a big chance. And more often than not, these movies are misses. But yeah, these movies always will have a special place in my heart, which is why I wanted to do this miniseries in general. And I think this particular film is the best example of that. I also think this is a good example of how these movies are often kind of flawed. Like, those structural things, they're kind of flaws in the film. The biggest gripe I have with this movie is, I think that you guys kind of touched on it with Valerian. I think Dane DeHaan, which I think he's a pretty solid actor in the right role, he is hilariously miscast in this. Mm-hmm. He's supposed to be this, like
charming, Han Solo,
Han Solo kind of guy. And he's this little, like, squirrely dude who's just like, hey, what's up, Laureline? I'm, like, 5'8", and, like, I'm a charming dude. And he's good when he's like the Green Goblin or some shit. And
Chronicle.
Yeah. He's a fucking creepy incel who gets superpowers and is evil. Like, that's the Dane DeHaan that I want to see, not as a swashbuckler.
Which you have to feel bad for him, because he, you feel like he should be typecasted in those kind of roles, but then it's like, it just doesn't work, you know?
Yeah, but he's great. He's great in those roles, you know?
Yeah, like, I know. Hey. Yeah.
But yeah, he is not good. Like, and it's just,
yeah, he's not too great. Yeah.
Even in that
Quibi RIP series, like, he plays like a creeper, like a murderer, essentially, like, you know, serial killer.
Sounds about right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but, and that's another thing about these movies, except for probably Speed Racer, I think a lot of these movies have just like a really, really, like, kind of not glaring, but like a big flaw in them that you can kind of point to and be like, yeah, why is this here? Like, what is going on with this? So that's why I think this movie is the perfect encapsulation of, if you want to, like, watch a movie that is just, if you're only going to watch one big swing, you're going to only watch one of these kind of movies. I would say either Speed Racer, if you want to watch the best one, but if you want to watch the most one, it's this one.
You can see that, but yeah, definitely agree with Speed Racer. But one thing I really, really liked that really had to be like a social commentary is when they're explaining the different, like, the three big major species of the city, where there's, like, the ones that are, like, water. They're like, oh, they maintain, like, the water functioning and all that stuff. And I think, like, they all have, like, really good jobs that take care of. And then there's another race that are like, oh, these guys take care of the technology. And, like, they're the banking and the financial guys. What I absolutely love is right after they say that, they go, the humans, their economy is in fucking destruction. It's in turmoil. Their streets are disgusting. There's garbage everywhere. Crime is rampant. And I'm like, of course it would be the humans. That had me fucking dying. Like, I was cracking up. And I was like, I still appreciate that they could at least throw in a little social commentary in there for a quick minute.
Yeah.
Just to be like, hey, you know, we have so much going on. Let's just add this really fast.
Mm. Show that to the government and see, like, this is why we need a large stimulus check.
Fuck $600.
Yeah.
Shit.
yeah,
man. It's definitely a fun one. I definitely, like you said, these big swing ones are going to be a lot of fun to do, and I hope everybody else is looking forward to them, because they're fun, man. Like, these, it's kind of nice, and I know what you mean about being refreshing, because you're like, you know, you kind of get used to the same thing after a while. You're like, oh, this is going to happen, that's going to happen, and with that, just like, for the law, you're like, oh, yes, I'm in this thing, but yeah.
Any last thoughts on well, I, Alan, I know you said you'd recommend it. I would definitely recommend it. Ariel, how about you?
I would recommend it. You know, like, for the things that you said, if you just want to, like, just the all hand, you know, no holds bar fun fest, then definitely check it out. But yeah, like, just don't go into it expecting, like, a a, you know, like a plot that doesn't diverge and things that don't make sense, but you just have to shrug like, oh, okay, kind of thing. You know, it's very much like a within those instances, like a history lesson, and like a teacher like says something very random, like, oh yeah, did you know that you know, like insects, you know, or this insect or this king had nine toes on one foot or something like that, you know, like you're like, cool. Like, but move on, yeah. You know, fun fact. It's very much like that kind of like interrupting fun fact kind of thing. But overall, yeah, like, I mean, just for the visuals, it is very incredible. Really good, like, backstory. And I feel like it invokes like, oh, I want to know more about that. But, you know, it is a really good lore to the movie.
Yeah, and I'm always a sucker for like lore and world building and stuff. So, mm-hmm. you know, yeah, this movie and these movies in general kind of right in my alley.
It would work very much, it would work really well as a series, like even in a mini series, like just because you want to live more and explore more of this world, you know.
Although I don't know if like you would be able to do it with the budget, and like how you said, mm-hmm. I think that Alan, you said this would be good in the 90s. I think, like, I know what you're saying, but like, there's no way the technology would have been able to make it like it. Like mm-hmm. all the stuff they have, where it just looks so like immense, and like, you know, there's stuff where they're like in two different dimensions at the same time, and all the unique things that they were able to do with the technology that you just couldn't have done in, you know, like 1997 or whatever. And the same thing I think with a TV show, there is a lot, and it would be really cool to see the world building over that, but, and you, I don't know. Yeah. Mm. But yeah, I think that about does it. Thank you guys for talking about this weird ass movie with me. I had a lot of fun talking about it. And I'm looking forward to, you know, kind of going over the other big swings and doing the whole month of this. And, you know, for anybody who isn't aware, we're going to be, you know, doubling our episodes for this January for the new year. So every week, every Monday, as opposed to every other Monday, we're going to be having a new episode for you here on Underrated, talking about these other big swing movies. And I actually wrote a post on Medium. So if you guys, you know, like want to get kind of, you know, some more in-depth thoughts about these big swing movies, just go ahead and check me out on Medium. Derek McDuff, I've got that. Story up just on big swings. And if you guys like this, we do a couple other podcasts as well. Ariel does one called You've Never Seen. I don't know if you wanted to talk about that a little bit, Ariel.
It's a movie that essentially introduced somebody to a movie that's considered a staple of pop culture or cinematic history, or just one that I might throw in once in a while, one that I cannot believe personally that they've never seen. So yeah, that's mine. Look for the green screaming woman when you search for it.
Yep. And then I've also got another podcast that I do called Gateway Episodes, where I introduce people to TV shows, or people introduce them to me via a gateway episode, so kind of an iconic or interesting episode of the show. You know, I've had Alan and Ariel on there a bunch of times, and, you know, they've introduced me to shows and vice versa. And I'm almost done, by the way, going through Hannibal, Alan, and holy shit, that show is fucking great. So,
telling you guys.
So yeah, if you guys want to hear some more of the three of us talk, check out those shows, you know, or listen to some more of this, because we've got a good back catalog. But yeah, that
please
is
do. If you got nothing else to do, if you got nothing else to do, I know a lot of people are at home right now. I was at home for a long time too. Just go back and listen to them, man. If you got nothing else to do, do it. It's fun.
Yeah. We have a lot of fun doing them, so we hope you guys have as much fun listening to them. But that about wraps it up. So I'll see you guys in another life.
Bye. Thanks for being amazing.
Well, take it easy, everybody.